Sometimes there's a quiet grace and nobility that comes with enduring immeasurable suffering. Some people have the ability to maintain hope in the promise of tomorrow despite unyielding fear and death. Simon Deng and Peter Nook are two such men, and they're also two of the lost boys of the Sudan. Network coverage like this from NBC, ABC, and CBS dominated the news in the late 1980s and 90s and shortly before 9/11, as journalists attempted to shed light on the widening war in the southern Sudan. A byproduct of British colonialism, the Sudan is a country largely shackled together with Arab Muslims in the north and black Christians in the south. As seen in this ABC broadcast footage, in 1987, the Khartoum Arab government systematically began driving people from their villages in the south. What followed was a mass exodus of young boys who were forced to flee their homes or die. They were called the Lost Boys by the relief workers because of the Peter Pan story. The boys spent 3 months struggling to make their way to Ethiopia and the sanctuary of refugee camps. Simon Deng and Peter Nook were both just 7 years old when the Khartoum-based government began their war against their countrymen in the south.
Most majority of the village was burned down to the ground. Everything was destroyed. And there was no other, you know, means of support that they can get. If your shelter house had been destroyed, burned down, with all the food in there, everything is completely gone. So now you have to start from the crash. You start from the, you know, from zero. And then you don't have any kind of stuff. And it was tough.
The young girls had value. They could be sold into slavery or marriage. The fate of the young boys, however, was even more perilous. The Khartoum government decided it was easier to kill children rather than to face them as young men with weapons. And so, the killing began. The village elders managed to save many of the boys and get them on the road. And it was a day that Peter Nook has seared into his memory.
We fear that day, we fear, because a lot of people lay down, they cannot walk. So the few older, they come and went out the porters and collect all the lost boys we were hiding. And they keep pushing us work to collect them where the people scatter.
With little or no food, water, or shelter, only those with the strongest will manage to survive. Numbers vary. However, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees believe that somewhere between 30,000 and 27,000 young boys began their journey to their first refugee camp.
It's hard to remember how many people lost on the way. We had a lot of people dying on the way with a lot of different, you know, difficulties that they couldn't even make it. And there was no food, no water. And the other had, like, you know, homesick, which is emotionally hard for them to go because they're not with their mom and their dad.
Some lost the will to live, and they died along the way. Others were simply too young or too weak to keep up. Adding to the chaos and the misery, lions hunted and picked off those that were unable to keep moving.
According to Dinka people, they're saying, some older people, they told us that if you saw the lion, and if you don't look at eye, so can you took your eye away and walk like you are playing a little bit, but if you look direct eye, they will jump you.
Many, like Simon Deng, had an unwavering faith, and even at seven, that fueled his endurance.
What actually kept me going is the faith that I have and a lot of advice from my parent that encouraged me to choose that path or to choose light in that particular time. Because what they tell you, if you give up, that's it, basically, that's it. But if you keep trying, you might have to make it, you're gonna make it. And at some point, you will.
For those that had survived the 3 months on the road and managed to make their way to Ethiopia, Life in the refugee camp was extremely difficult. Despite help from the United Nations, the Lost Boys continued to struggle for survival.
It's very bad, the time we went there is very bad because there is no much food and no shelter and no like blanket and no like sopria so that we can cook food. It's bad.
Life improved somewhat in the third year of the camp, and the UNHCR built a hospital and the Red Cross helped with the food. However, after 3 years, the Ethiopian government fell and the Lost Boys were forced to flee for a second time. The children spent more than a month crossing back through the Sudan and then into Kenya. Along the way, they were shelled by the Khartoum troops, and once again, they suffered a number of casualties.
You have to be off the road. They were shooting a bunch of them, you know, artilleries, and they shoot it in the center in the road. If you got there, you got out of the way. So we have to be out off the road, in the main road, you know, somewhere in the wood along. And but at that particular time when I was 11 or 12, it was a little bit better than the first one. Now, I can run. I can walk faster enough.
As if their ordeal wasn't enough, the Lost Boys had to cross rivers to make it to the safety of Kenya. As depicted in these drawings by one of the youngsters that survived, they also had to face more troops, drowning, and also crocodiles.
Yeah, there is a crocodile, if God help you, what can you do? So can you stay other side, and there is a local tribe called Anuak, they come and kill you, and they kill most of the Lost Boys, and throw them in the river. So you need to go. If you're lucky, you cross the river.
First of all, you have to swim under the water, which is crocodile, they will never attack you even under the water. If they see you coming, they will run away from you, because they thought maybe you can attack them. But you are above the water, on top of the water, sure. They're the one, you know, seeing you, but you cannot see them. And so I swim under the water, and then in the middle, so I pop up just to catch my breath. And then I only have one person, you know, to the other side of the river. I can't help any other people, many.
Those that survived the second trek would go on to live at the refugee camp at Kakuma in Kenya. Life was still very difficult, but boys like Simon and Peter focused on their education and the hope of a better life. They would spend another 9 years at the Kakuma refugee camp.
It's very interesting that you write down with your finger on the dirt. You can write a whole paragraph on the sand. Teachers, they might just come and read it and correct it. You can do math down there on the dirt and follow all the steps that you need to take.
Estimates vary on the numbers, but it is believed that around 11,000 of the Lost Boys somehow survived. Starting in 2001, around 3,800 of the youngsters, who are now young men, resettled to the United States, where they're now living in 39 cities across the U.S. With the help of various religious organizations and groups, a number of the Lost Boys have made a remarkable transition to living in America. Both Simon and Peter ended up calling San Jose home, and they became United States citizens.
I was very excited, happy, you know, to see a new place. And I never been to this country before, so was hoping that basically when I go to the U.S., I have to continue with my education. Despite whatever the condition are, my thought, that's the best opportunity to take. Just take that chance, don't let it go. Because some of the windows, they might be open, and sometimes they close. So when your windows are opportunity open, just take it. That's one more time. Water is a liquid.
The men work two jobs, 16 solid hours a day, and still find time to go to college. Simon works for the Santa Clara Water District, teaching water conservation. And he hopes someday to become a nurse and return home and to help his people. Peter's employed at a printing company, and he's been instrumental in helping Sudanese orphans, and he has personally returned to the Sudan 4 times to help 38 orphans relocate to a school in Kenya.
The time we came here, we are still behind. But the time we came here, American friend come and help us a lot. So it's kind of appreciation passed to them. And then they gave it to us, and we want to give it to our people. And that is God brought us to this country. So we are not coming for ourselves. We are coming, God sent us so that we can come and help people there in Baku.
It has been said that the greatest test of courage on earth is to bear defeat without losing heart. Simon Deng and Peter Nook remain warriors of the heart.